Okay, control charts for attributes. Okay, since we are already familiar with control charts, we know the procedure to plot control chart. So in the same manner, so we are going to plot a few more control charts. Okay, so here in this module, so we are going to consider control charts for attributes. So in the previous module, so we consider control charts for variables. So we know the difference between variables and attributes. So variable means they are quantifiable. That means you can measure them. If it's a dimension, so it is a continuously varying data. So in between 18 and 19 mm, so you can find infinite number of values. Okay, that is variable data. Whereas in case of attributes, it is like binary. Okay, accept or reject, good or bad. Okay, defective or acceptable product. So these are attributes. So where you cannot directly convert them into values. Okay, you cannot convert quality characteristic into a value, into a numerical value. So those are considered as attributes. Okay, so examples are good, bad, presence, absence. Okay, so here defective or not defective, or conformance or non-conformance. Okay, so that is meaning of attributes. So here we are going to plot P chart, NP chart, then C chart. Okay, so like that there are few charts which are related to attributes. So in previous module we have plotted X bar R chart and X bar S chart or X bar sigma chart. Okay, objective of this module is so you must be able to develop and interpret. That means after plotting a control chart, you must be able to analyze it. You must be able to come to conclusion regarding whether the process is in control or out of control. Then if you are working in a company, okay, so if there are few points which are out of the control limits, in practical application you need to find the reason for getting points out of the control limit. Then you have to search for assignable causes. Okay, again, assignable causes may be because of the machine, because of the man, okay, and because of the supplier of the material or raw material. Okay, so you have to evaluate what is the reason. If you are able to find the assignable cause, so the purpose of plotting control chart is served. Okay, then you can eliminate those assignable causes so that you don't get defective products. So these are the contents. So again, here also you are considering control charts for fraction defectives, then control charts for sample, constant sample size and variable sample size. In previous module, so we have constructed control charts by considering only constant sample size, constant value of n for all subgroups or all different samples. Whereas here we are also going to consider variable sample size. So n will vary for different samples. Okay, that also we are going to consider in this module. Then guidelines for implementing control charts. Okay, first attributes charts are generally not as informative as variable charts because there is more information in a numerical measurement than in merely classifying a unit as conforming or non-conforming. Okay, you can consider the example of giving result. Okay, so if result is given only in terms of pass or fail, that lacks detail. That means you don't get an idea regarding how much marks you have scored. Okay, so whereas in case of variable charts, so you will get that detail. Okay, how much marks you have scored, you can get the detail. In case of attribute, it will give only whether the product is acceptable or it should be rejected. Okay, like fail or pass. Okay, so that is the demerit. Next, attribute charts are particularly useful in service industries and in non-manufacturing quality improvement efforts because so many of the quality characteristics found in these environments are not easily measured on a numerical scale. Okay, suppose if someone say, okay, what is the quality of the service in the hotel? So usually you'll say good, bad, average. So they are like attributes data where you are not giving any numbers. Even though you may give some stars, but again that is an indication of qualitative characteristics, not quantitative. Okay, next, control charts for fraction non-conforming, that is P chart. Okay, so P is nothing but it is the fraction non-conforming. Non-conforming means defective. Conforming means it is to the standards, to within the limits. So that means that is a good one. Non-conforming means it is a defective. The fraction non-conforming is defined as the ratio of the number of non-conforming items in a population to the number of items in that population. Okay, suppose if there are 100 units of a product, okay, out of 100, if 10 are defective, okay, that is fraction non-conforming. So you will get 0.1 as p value. That is the fraction non-conforming. So total number of units manufactured is 100. Out of 100, so 10 are defective. That means fraction non-conforming will be this 10 by 100. Okay, so you will get 0.1 or 10%. Okay, so here you are considering in decimals, it will be 0.1. So next, sample fraction non-conforming means, so here you are not considering entire population. Suppose if you have manufactured 100 units of a product, that is the entire population. Now you are picking only 10 samples. Okay, out of 10, if 2 are defective, okay, that is the sample fraction non-conforming. Now you will calculate it as 2 by 10, that will be 0.2. Okay, that is the sample fraction non-conforming. That means you are picking only few items from the population. Okay, and you are considering out of these samples, okay, how many are defective. So that is sample fraction non-conforming. That is defined as ratio of the number of non-conforming units in the sample to the sample size. Suppose, as I told you, so if the sample size is 10, you have picked 10 out of 100, and out of 10, if 2 are defective, then 2 by 10, that is 0.2, will give you sample fraction non-conforming. This is the equation P cap. Okay, this cap represents it is a sample fraction non-conforming. Suppose if it is just P, that is fraction non-conforming. Okay, sample, this cap represents it is sample fraction non-conforming. D is number of non-conforming units, that is defectives, number of defectives. N is sample size. Next, so mean will be given by P. And variance will be given by sigma square in various variance of this sample fraction non-conforming. Okay, that is given by P of 1 minus P by N. So again, if you want just sigma, so you have to transfer root to right side. So sigma will P will, cap will be equal to root of P of 1 minus P by N, like that if this equation can be written. Next, and development and operation of the control chart. So this is the general equation, so which we discussed earlier also. The general model for the Shiva control chart is as follows, where mean value is the target value. Okay, and this deviation up towards up and low, towards positive and negative. So this is the sigma is standard deviation, L is standard deviation in terms of units. So it may be 1, 2, 3, 1 sigma, 2 sigma, 3 sigma. Usually for control charts, we will consider plus or minus 3 sigma. Okay, that is the standard deviation unit, that is L. Next, that true fraction non-conforming, P in the production process is known, R is a specified standard value, then you are going to make use of these equations to find control limits, upper control limit and lower control limit. Central line is given by P. Okay, so P plus 3 sigma, and this root of P of 1 minus P by N, that is nothing but sigma, as I told you earlier. So here variance is given by this equation. If you want just sigma, so you have to apply root of P of 1 minus P by N. So here we did that. So instead of sigma, we are writing root of P of 1 minus P by N. So this is P minus 3 sigma. Sigma is nothing but root of P of 1 minus P by N for this case, for P chart. Suppose in most of the cases, you don't know this P value. Okay, what you know is, so you will have some data regarding number of defectives, number of non-conforming units, okay, within the sample. Based on that, so you are going to calculate this P bar. Okay, that's why when the process fraction non-conforming P is not known, then it must be estimated from observed data. That means same equation, instead of P, we will consider P bar. Okay, that is the fraction non-conforming average of sample non-conforming. Okay, so average of sample fraction non-conforming, that is given by P bar. So that we are going to consider if we don't know P. Okay, next. So with the help of the problem, we will understand it in a better way. The fraction non-conforming in the ith sample, that is D, non-conforming units in a sample. Okay, so as we discussed, so if you want to find out sample non-conforming, that is given by P cap, so you have to consider number of defectives by sample size. So that is Di by N. Then, so if you add all the P cap values of all samples and divide it by number of samples, that is M, you will get P bar. Okay, so or directly you can find out P bar by Di Mn. So or you can write this as, even this as P cap I by M. So whichever is convenient, so you can use that equation to find P cap. So initially you are going to find this P cap value for all the samples. Then if you add them and divide by number of samples, that is this equation, so you will get P cap. Or directly you can substitute these values and you can get P bar. Okay, so both are possible. So this is average of sample non-conforming, fraction sample non-conforming. Okay, now consider the problem. Frozen orange juice concentrate is packed in, okay, in a cardboard can. So these cans, so this is, there will be a cardboard can like this. Okay, this is an example. These cans are formed on a machine by spinning them from cardboard stock and attaching a metal bottom panel. By inspection of a can, we may determine whether when filled it could possibly leak either on the side seam or around the bottom tank. Such a non-conforming can has an improper seal on either the side seam or the bottom panel. So here, this is the can made up of cardboard sheet. It's cardboard sheet, okay, and this is the specified standard, so for of the material in cardboards. Okay, so here defect may be because of two reasons. Okay, there may be leakage on the side seam. Side seam means, so here, so cardboard sheet, so here somewhere it should join. Okay, that join, so at the point of this joint, so there may be leakage. Or at the bottom, so you are going to add one more metallic layer. Okay, so because of that also there may be leakage. Okay, now, so you are evaluating, so how many cans manufactured. Okay, so they are defective. That means they results in leakage. Okay, how many will not result in leakage, and how many will result in leakage. Okay, that we are evaluating. Okay, so now 30 samples of sample size 50. So totally you are considering 30 different samples. That means you are considering a time interval. Okay, you are picking 50 units. Okay, after every half hour interval. Okay, so you are picking 50 units after 30 minutes of production. Then again 50 units after 60 minutes of production, then once again 50 units after 90. So you are considering sample number 1 as 50 collected after 30 minutes, sample number 2 as or you can subgroup them also. Okay, in each subgroup, so you can consider subgroup number 1 as 50 which are collected after 30 minutes of production, then subgroup number 2 or sample number 2, so that also consists of 50 units. Okay, so that will be taken after 60 minutes of production, then after 90 minutes of production once again 50 are collected. Okay, so like that it will be done. So 30 samples, like the 30 times it will be taken. So in 3 shifts, 30 samples of sample size 50 cans, each were selected at half hour intervals over a 3 shift period in which the machine was in continuous operation. The data are shown in table. There is a table in next slide. Set up a control chart to improve the fraction of non-conforming cans produced by this machine. Okay, so here you should get an idea regarding so how many defective cans which will result in leakage will be produced. So that is the that is what we are evaluating using this P chart. Okay, so this is the given data. So along with this problem, so in the question itself, so you will get this data. Okay, sample numbers. So totally there are 30 samples. Okay, 30 times sampling was done. Next, number of non-conforming cans. Okay, so every time after 30 minutes, so you are choosing 50 units of can. Okay, out of 50, 12 are non-conforming. That means 12 are defective. Then, so you can find out fraction non-conforming. Fraction non-conforming, that is P cap will be di by n. Okay, di is 12, n is 50. So 12 by 50. Okay, that is the value of P cap. P cap 1 will be 12 by 50. So what is the value? So if 12 by 50 means how much you will get? 12 divided by 50. What is the value? So it will be 0.24. Okay, similarly, for second one, out of 50, 15 are non-conforming, that is 15 are defectives. 15 by 50, that will be 0.30. Similarly, 8 by 50, that is 0.16. Then 10 by 50, 0.20. Like that, you can find out fraction non-conforming. That means fraction non-conforming, it is nothing but here you are considering, since it is sample fraction non-conforming. That is 12 by 50, 15 by 50, 8 by 50, 10 by 50, 4 by 50. Like that you can find the values. Okay, that, so in few problems, so this value also directly given in few problems. In few problems, you have to find on your own. Okay, for that you have to use that equation. P cap I is equal to di by n. So di is 12, n is 50. Since in the given problem they have given n is equal to 50, sample size is 50. So you have to apply that. So you have to find this column. So that is sample fraction non-conforming. Okay. After finding these values, so you can find out P bar. So you can add all these values and divide it by m. M is 30 for this case. Okay, add all the values and divide that by 30, you will get P bar as 0.2313. Next, after finding P bar, you can find out control limits. Okay, both upper control limit and lower control limit, central line, all this you can find. Since you know n, n is 50, P bar value 0.2313. Okay, control limits, upper control limit and lower control limit. After this, so you can go for plotting control chart. Okay, this is the control chart. Okay, first, again same procedure, already I explained how to draw control chart in previous module. Okay, first on the x-axis consider sample number. Okay, totally, so there are 30 subgroups or samples. Okay, here, so it is totally 30. So on x-axis you have to consider 30 divisions. Okay, next, on y-axis, depending on the value, so here, since it is a P chart, you are plotting values of P. So that is, you are plotting sample fraction non-conforming, that is P cap is nothing but it is a P value. Okay, P is for population, P cap is for sample. Okay, so you are plotting this value. So on y-axis, that is fraction non-conforming. Now you should look for the value okay, minimum and maximum value. Okay, minimum value is 0.08, maximum value is 0.48. Okay, now you should consider units on y-axis such that so you are able to include these values. Okay, 0.08 to 0.48. So it is better to choose. You can choose 0.1 as one unit, or you can choose 0.05 as one unit. Okay, if you choose 0.1 as one unit, so you need 5 divisions. If you choose 0.05 as one unit, you need 10 divisions, since it should include 0.48 also. Okay, here the author of the textbook considered 0.05. Okay, so you can consider 0.1 or 0.05, your wish. Okay, next, so depending on the upper control limit and lower control limit, so lower control limit value is 0.0524. okay, so mark that value 0.0524 and draw the horizontal line. Next, so consider the center line value, so that is 0.2313. so 0.2313, so mark that point, draw a horizontal line. So this will be center line. Next, so consider upper control limit, so it is 0.4102. so again mark that and draw the horizontal line. Okay, after that, so consider individual values of p cap. For sample number 1, 0.24, so you will draw this. Next, for sample number 2, 0.30. next, sample number 3, 0.16. for 4, 0.20. for 5, okay, 0.08. so like that you have to plot these points, okay, for all 30 samples, then connect them using scale. This should be straight lines. Connect them using scale and you will get this chart. Okay, so now, so after plotting this, so what you will conclude, whether the process is in control or out of control, by looking at the control chart, what you can say? Okay, so my question is, so whether, so you have a control chart, by looking at the points, location of the points, okay, what conclusion you can draw, whether the process is in control or out of control? Okay, Abhishek, DK. Abhishek. Ajay Kumar. Okay, what you can say, whether the process is in control or out of control? Ganapati Nayak. Chinmay MG. Okay, already you have attended CIE and you have drawn X bar R chart. Okay, you have concluded. So what conclusion you can draw from this control chart? So anyone can answer. Charan Raj. Okay, so now, so you have to look at the points, okay, whether points are within the control limits or out of control limits. Okay, so here you can see So these two. Okay, out of control. Okay, so Bharat typed the answer out of control. So this after plotting control chart, we can say the process is out of control because there is an indication of out of control. That is, there are few points which are above the upper control limit. That means outside the control limits. Okay, so for sample number 15. And for sample number 23, okay, you have points beyond the control limits. So that means, so there are some signals. Okay, so this is an initial indication. Okay, you need to evaluate what are the reasons why you are getting these points outside. That is the second phase. In practical application, you can do that. Okay, in theoretical case, so you cannot do that. What you can say is, so there is a say, signal of out of control, so we can say the process is out of control because a few points are beyond the control limits. Like that, we can say in practical application, quality engineers should evaluate. Okay, what is happening? Since it is a sample number 15, it is happening after seven and a half hours of operation. Okay, so for every 30 minutes we are taking samples. That means 15 sample means it is after 7.5 hours. Okay, at that time what happened? Okay, whether it is because of machine, whether it is because of the operator, or whether it is because of some other reason. Okay, like that he has to evaluate. Okay, so in case of control charts, so we can, the control limit that we are going to obtain for initial samples, so they are considered as trial limits. Okay, that is the phase one of control chart where we are plotting control chart for initial samples. Okay, then what we'll do in phase two, so we are going to consider few more samples. Okay, then we are going to finalize on the control limits. So initially itself we don't finalize. Okay, after evaluating for two or three times, so we will finalize the control limits. So initial control limits are called trial control limits. Okay, next here sample 15 and 23 plot above the upper control limit, so the process is not in control, that is out of control. These points must be investigated to see whether an assignable cause can be determined. Okay, so that the quality engineers need to do. Next, so for the same problem, okay, so consider revising. Okay, in the question, if they ask, if required, revise the control limits. That means whenever you are getting points outside the control limits, you should revise. Suppose if all the points lie within the upper control limit and lower control limit, so revision is not required. Okay, like that you can conclude. Okay, suppose in the question, if they ask, okay, if the process is out of control, revise the control limits, then what is the procedure that you need to follow? Okay, that you will understand here. Sample 15 and 20, so this I told you earlier. So next, assuming that in sample 15, in the previous problem, assignable cause due to new material, and in sample 23, assignable cause due to new operator are found, revise the control limits of the previous problem. Okay, so now, so we have control limits, lower control limit as 0.0524, upper control limit as 0.4102. So for revision, what we should do is, so we should exclude these two points, that is the points which are out of the control limits. Point number 15 and 23 must be excluded while calculating control limits. Okay, instead of 30, so here I have considered only 28 because I need to eliminate sample number 15 and 23. Okay, this is sample number 15. And this is sample number 23. Okay, these two must be eliminated. So now, so this will be, now M will be 28. Next, so So if you consider d bar value, okay, so after adding all di values, okay, so you got 347. Here you need to eliminate 2, that means 22 plus 24, totally 46. 347 minus 46, it will be 301. Okay, since we are eliminating 15, sample number 15 and 23, so we are considering di values of only remaining 28 samples. We are excluding 23 and 15. That means you must subtract 46 from this value. It will be 301. Okay, then you will get new p bar value. This is the new value for p bar. Okay, next. So you will get upper control limit and lower control limit. This is the upper control limit and this is the lower control limit. So you have revised the control limit. Next, for plotting control chart. Okay, so central line, so we are considering 0.21, okay, for central line here. So here we are considering new limits, lower control limit, it is 0.0407. Okay, upper control limit, we are considering 0.3893. Okay, but there is one thing to observe. So on the control chart, you are not excluding sample number 15 and sample number 23. So you have not excluded them in the control chart. But while calculating control limits, so you have excluded them. Okay, so in the control chart, you are representing them. Again, once again, they are out of limits. Why you are representing them even after revising the control limits is, so one who is looking at the control chart, okay, he will get an idea regarding, so what happened, so for sample 15 and sample 23, that means what happened after 7.5 hours of operation of the machine, okay, what happened after 23 means, so 11.5 hours operation, okay, so because of some issues with the operator, so you are getting control limit out of it. Because of some issues with the material, so you are getting our control point out of upper control limit. Next, so after revision, so you are getting one more point out of control limit. So this one. So now, again, quality engineer should evaluate what is the reason for getting this point out of control limit. If there is an assignable cause, okay, once again they should eliminate this point, once again they have to revise. Suppose after evaluation, if there is no assignable cause, okay, they can continue with this control limits. Okay, chance causes, anyhow we cannot do anything. Okay, chance causes, they are part of the process. Okay, we are being quality engineers, we are worried about only assignable causes. Okay, if assignable cause found for this point, that is point number 21, okay, so this point also should be eliminated. Next time while revising, you have to consider only 27 samples. Again, d value of 27 samples, you have to find out, once again you have to find out p bar and upper control limit, lower control limit, once again you have to plot the control chart. Okay, or else, so you can say, so same, this upper control limit and lower control limit are retained because there is no assignable cause for sample number 21, like that you can conclude. Okay. So you will get the summary here. Samples 15 and 23 are not excluded from the chart, but they have been excluded from the control limit calculations. Indication on a control chart, the unusual points, that is out of control limit points, are run, like 8 consecutive points above central line or below central line, okay, or 8 consecutive points in an increasing trend or decreasing trend or cyclic pattern. So they are unusual points. Okay, indication on a control chart, the unusual points, process adjustments, are the type of investigation made at a particular point in time, forms a useful record for future process analysis and should become a standard practice in control chart usage. That means this points which are beyond the control limits should be indicated on the control chart plotted for revised control limits, because they will give proper understanding of what is happening during production or what is happening during a process. Okay, so that's why on the control chart they must be represented. So after plotting control chart for revised control limits, so you are for sample 21, so also you are getting out of control limit. So sample 21 exceeds the upper control limit in the revised P chart. If analysis of the data does not produce any reasonable or logical assignable cause for this, the point will be retained and new control limits can be used for future samples. So that means, no, if no assignable cause founded for point number 21, you can retain these control limits for further evaluation. Okay, these are this will become final control limits. Okay, suppose if analysis of the data shows an assignable cause for this, the point will be eliminated and control limits are revised once again, like what we did for previous two samples.